Are you able to view the screen? Okay. We'll wait for one or two more minutes and then we'll start with our lecture. So in our last lecture, we were discussing about the different ways the IOs are implemented. If you remember, we have either the isolated IO or memory mapped IO. As we have discussed, in case of isolated IO, different address, it is provided with different address rather than that of the memory's address. Okay, different address space will be provided for the IO device. Whereas in case of memory mapped IO, the same memory addresses are provided to the IO addresses. Okay, so say suppose if I'm having 16 IO devices which are having the address ranging from 20000 hex, because it is a memory mapped IO, it is of 20 bits because each memory location is addressed by 20 bits, and the last address would be 2000F. Okay, so this would be my last address if I'm having 16 IO devices which are connected. Okay, so these memory range from 2000. These address range from 20000 to 2000F that is allocated for the IO device, and these addresses cannot be used for the memory. It cannot be used for the memory. Is it clear? Whereas in case of IO mapped IO, if we are having 16 devices, say suppose I am having the address of IO device, IO port is addressed by 16 bits, ranging from 2000 till 200F, okay? Then the same address, I can also use it for the memory. You are having different address space for the IO device as well as for the memory. Is it clear, everyone? The difference between IO mapped IO as well as memory mapped IO? If you are still not clear, you let me know, okay? So since in case of memory mapped IO, we are using the memory addresses, the address of the 20 bits, and it is since it is a memory mapped IO, we can use all the memory related instructions to access even these IO ports. Whereas in case of IO mapped IO, we can access the IO ports using only the in as well as out instruction. These are the two instructions which are used to access the IO ports. It is clear? Okay, so a part of the memory address space is lost because we are using this for the IO devices, whereas here no memory space is lost. Okay, it is not affected because you are having a separate port address as well as separate memory address. so the addresses for IO mapped IO, or it is also known as isolated IO device, these are called as ports. Okay. Hope everyone is clear with this, the difference. Next, we'll go through the two instructions which are used to access the IO ports in case of IO mapped IO, or you can say in case of isolated IO. Okay. And usually, all the Intel processors, they use this isolated IO. Followed? So the very first instruction is in. Okay. The in. Here, by default, the data is inputted from the port whose address is provided here to the accumulator. Are you getting this? So that this is a default register, the accumulator. So accumulator here in our 8086 is, if it is an 8-bit data, it is an AL register, whereas if it is a 16-bit data, it is a AX register. Is it clear, everyone? Okay. So in instruction, the content of the data which is provided at this port, that would be copied into the accumulator. And the accumulator is nothing but, if it is an 8-bit data, it is an AL register, and if it is a 16-bit data, then it is in the AX register. The IN instruction copies data from port to the AL or AX register. If an 8-bit port is read, so here the port can be of either 8-bit or it can be a 16-bit. If 8-bit port is read, that means if the port port is of 8-bit and only 8-bit would be copied, then that data would be into the AL register. Whereas if it is a 16-bit port, that means if it is providing 16-bit, then it is copied to the AX register. Okay. Now, this in instruction, it has two possible formats. One is known as a fixed port or fixed address of the port is provided, or it can be a variable port address. Okay. So if with the in instruction, if directly the 8-bit value is provided, this is a port address, then it is a fixed port. This type of instruction is a fixed port instruction. So here, what does it indicate? The port with the address 0C8. Okay. So since it is in the AL register, that means this port is an 8-bit port. That means it is providing an 8-bit value, and that 8-bit is copied into the AL register. Whereas in this particular example, this 34H is the port address, and that port would provide 16-bit data, and those 16-bit data is copied into the AX register. Is it clear, everyone? Okay. So these are the example of a fixed port type of addressing. Whereas in case of variable port, okay. And one more thing, in case of fixed port, the port address is by default, it would be only of 8 bits. It cannot be of 16 bits. Whereas in case of variable port, okay, so the port address by default, it is provided into the DX register, okay, before the IN instruction. So whatever be the value of DX register, that would become the port address. Follow? So for example, since we are using the DX register, and since it is a 16-bit register, now the port value can be ranging from 0000 till FFFFH. Is it clear, everyone? In the earlier example of fixed port, the port address was only of 8 bits. You cannot provide here 16-bit value. Whereas in case of variable port, the port address should be provided into the DX register. And since DX register is of 16-bit, the range of port address would be ranging, it would be from 0 to 0000 till FFFFH. Follow? So, and the IN instruction does not change, or it does not affect any of the flag register, as we know that the IN instruction is also a data transfer instruction, isn't it? And all the data transfer instruction, it would not affect any of the flag. Flags are not affected. Flags are not affected. Follow? So here, move DX, comma. So you can see that this is the port address, and that we are copying it into the DX register. Follow? So if I write in AL, comma DX, that means the 8-bit value. So this is an 8-bit port. That means it provides 8-bit value. And that 8-bit value, I'm copying it into the AL register. Whereas if I'm providing it into the AX register, then that 16-bit value, which is provided by this port address, that would be into the AX register. Hope everyone is clear with this IN instruction. Hello, is this thing clear? IN means what? From the port, the data is copied into the accumulator. Now, the reverse of that is the OUT instruction. Okay, the same way here also. OUT instruction copies a byte from here, you mean to say? See, whenever there is an hex value, and if it starts with alphabet, I mean A to F, if you are having some, no, you cannot start with the alphabet. So if it is so, then you have to precede a zero here. Okay, so if you remember, even in the data segment, when you are providing some hex value, if you have tried for that, I don't know whether you have tried it or not. And if you are providing some hex value, then it has to be preceded with zero. Is it clear, everyone? The next instruction is out, port, comma, accumulator. That means what it has to do. The out means what? The data is transferred from the register, that is the accumulator, to some output port. So the port address is provided here. Okay. Now, again, the same way, either it can be a fixed port or the variable port. If it is a fixed port, then we can use only 8-bit as a fixed port. Okay, so the possible addresses for the fixed port is only 256, that is 00 till FF, because it would be of 8 bits. So that is 256 possible ports we can address. Whereas if I'm having variable port, okay, this is an example of a variable port where the port address, we are providing it into the DX register. Hello, is this thing clear? Okay, and similarly, if it is an 8-bit port, then the AL register's value would be copied to the port address, which is specified with the DX register. And if it is a 16-bit port, then the AX register's value would be specified to the port, which is pointed by the DX register. Okay, so these are the DX register is a default register here. You cannot use any other register like SI or BX or something like that. Okay, hope everyone is clear with the in as well as out instruction. This one also does not affect any of the flag, as we have discussed for the in instruction. So this is also a data transfer instruction, and hence it would not affect any of the flag registers. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Okay, so hope you all are clear with the in and out instruction. Now we'll see about the PPI, that is programmable peripheral interface. So if some peripheral device we want to interface with the processor, the number of ports which are provided by the processor, or the IO pins which is provided, we don't have any explicit IO pins to the processor. We have already gone through the pin diagram, isn't it? You don't find any of the IO pins provided with the processor. Okay, so we can connect some external IC, which is to interface with some peripheral device, okay, and that IC would again interact with the CPU. We'll see how this input as well as output would be carried out by this programmable peripheral interface. This is one IC would be provided, and that is nowadays within the processor itself, this IC is also embedded, okay, but we'll be studying how this IC would work, so that it can interface with some IO device. Either it can be a printer, or it can be a keyboard, etc. So how it will interface, that we'll see. Okay. So there are different ways of data transfer, parallel data transfer. Simple input output. That means suppose this is my CPU. This is my some IO device. Okay. And here we connect between these two. A PPI, that is programmable peripheral interface. So the very first type of data transfer is simple input output. That means as soon as, say, suppose this is an input device, as soon as the data is ready with the input, it would just provide that data to the PPI, and in turn it would provide to the CPU. Okay, there is no handshake signal. That means there is no interaction before data transfer or after data transfer between the IO device or the CPU, or between IO device as well as the PPI. So the very first one is simple input or output. Similarly, simple strobed input output. That means strobed input output means what? When the data is transferred from some IO device to the PPI, at the same data would be placed onto the bus, which is meant to transfer the data. And there would be one more signal saying that I have placed the valid data onto the bus. Because since it is an electronic device, there would be some value in the bus. But whether it is a valid or invalid, it would not be known. The PPI may not be known. Okay. So once the IO device would place the data onto the bus, it will send a signal saying that I'm having that I have already provided the valid data onto the bus. Okay, so this is an example of a strobed IO. Strobed IO means what? It would send a signal saying that a valid data is placed onto the bus. Then comes single handshake IO. Single handshake IO, handshaking means what? There would be, before data transfer, it would ask whether you are ready to accept the data. And after receiving the data, it will again acknowledge that I have received. So that is an example of a double handshake. Double handshake means what? Before data transfer, it would ask, and then after data transfer, it would acknowledge. In case of single handshake IO, the data would be pressed. As soon as it receives, it would just send that acknowledgement. So these are the various modes or various methods of data transfer between the input-output device as well as the CPU. Here, simple strobe. Simple strobe IO means what? See, onto the since we are the data is also passed through the bus. Okay, bus is means what? There would be some parallel conductors. Okay, and in this, if say suppose no data has been transferred, it may have some value 0, 1, 0, something would be there onto the bus. Do you agree to this? Okay, so what the PPI would do, it would accept this data, but it may not be a valid data. Getting? So once the, say suppose some data has been placed by this IO device onto the bus, then it will send a strobe signal. Okay, saying, and that strobe signal is sensed by this PPI. Strobe signal, when it is active, it implies that a valid data is there onto the bus. Okay, then this PPI would accept the data. Hope this is clear. Okay, so we'll see each one of them as we go further. Okay, the very first one, what we have discussed is simple IO. Simple IO means what? As soon as the data is ready, it would just place it onto the bus. Okay, so there is no handshaking or there is no, prior to data transfer or after data transfer, there is no signals which is provided. So this is simple IO. So this data transfer method is used when the IO device need no communication before the data transfer. There is no communication before as well as after the data transfer. Okay, say suppose you can imagine this as if you are posting some letter to, and you are putting that letter into the post box. Okay, a simple letter. Okay, so there is no acknowledgement whether the other end has received your letter or not. Do you agree to this? This is an example of simple IO. Hello, are you able to understand? Okay, there is no acknowledgement, and before putting the data onto the before placing the post onto the post box, you are not telling the other end that I am sending you the letter. Hope this is clear. Okay, so this is an example of a simple IO. So here this can be shown here in the cross lines on the wave. So this cross line, it implies that some valid data is placed here. It represents the time at which a new data byte comes valid on the output line of the port. Okay, so this, there is no handshake here, just it would place the data. Some IO device may place the data onto the bus, and that so at the instant at which it has placed, so that would be shown by this cross line. Okay, some of the lines may go low, some of the lines may go high, so that's why we are having some cross line. So just the data is placed onto the bus. Okay, this is an example of a simple IO. The next one is simple strobed IO. The strobed IO means what? Once the valid data is placed onto the bus, the input device may send a signal saying that I have placed a valid data onto the bus. Okay, the sending device. So the example for the strobed IO is a keyboard. Okay, the sending device, such as a keyboard, outputs parallel data onto the data line. So suppose you have pressed any key, that ASCII value of that key would be placed onto the bus. Okay, but at that bus, whether it is a valid data or not, it will come to know by looking at this strobe bar signal. So this is an active low signal. Okay, so you can see that once the key is pressed, the keyboard, what it will do, it will send a strobe bar signal saying that a valid key is pressed. If it has not sent the strobe bar signal, it might be possible that some data would be there onto the bus, which is connected between the keyboard as well as the processor, isn't it? So instead, it will send a strobe bar signal saying that a valid data is placed. So you can see that in this case, the valid data is placed here by the keyboard. Okay, and then it sends a strobe bar signal. By looking at this strobe bar signal, the processor would come to know that a valid data is there onto the bus and it would accept that data. Hope this is clear, everyone. The simple I/O. Then comes single handshake I/O. Okay. So as we have discussed, handshaking means what? It would send some acknowledgement after receiving a valid data. And before transmitting a valid data, it will send, as in case of strobed I/O, we have seen that some strobe signal would be provided saying that a valid data is pressed. So here we are using single handshake I/O. You can see that the peripheral device outputs some parallel data and sends strobe bar signal to the microprocessor. This is what we have learned as in case of simple I/O. It would place some parallel data and send the strobe bar signal to the microprocessor. Okay. So you can see that some valid data is placed here and it sends some strobe bar signal. Okay, then the processor detects this strobe bar signal. It will detect this strobe bar signal and it would get this data, okay, from the bus, and it sends an acknowledgement signal to the peripheral. After receiving the valid data, it sends an acknowledgement signal to the peripheral saying that I have received the valid data. Hope you are getting this. To indicate a data has been read, and now once this acknowledgement has been received, the next data would only be sent when it receives this acknowledgement. Before receiving this acknowledgement, it may not send the next data. Are you getting this? Now once more, if the next data has to be sent, then once this acknowledgement become high and then low, then only the next data would be sent. So microprocessor detects the strobe bar signal and sends acknowledgement to the peripheral to indicate data has been read, and peripheral can send the next data byte. Okay. Now by using this, it ensures that peripheral device does not send data until receiving until receiving system indicates with an acknowledgement that it is ready to receive next byte. This is what we have discussed. Okay, until this receiving system. So in this example, the receiving system is microprocessor. So until it indicates that I have received this valid data, the sender may not send a new data. Okay. So this is about a single handshake I/O. Okay. So here you can see that this is a peripheral device, a strobe bar signal. The parallel data input would be provided here. Parallel data would be provided to this PPI. It will send a strobe bar signal saying that a valid data is placed. And in turn, this PPI would receive this parallel data and it sends an acknowledgement signal to this peripheral. Hope this is clear. Okay. Now, next, we'll see about the double handshake. So here it should be double handshake. Here what happens? The sender asserts strobe bar low and the receiver raises its acknowledgement. Okay. See, the sender in the earlier examples, what it has done, if you go through this, after placing the valid data onto the data bus, then only the strobe bar signal becomes low. Okay, this is what we have studied. Whereas now what happens, you know, the strobe bar is low. Okay, first it will check whether the receiver is ready to accept the data. then only it would put that valid data onto the bus. Hope you are able to understand this. So you can see that. Okay, so here now you can see that the strobe bar is low here, but before that it has not, before it has received this acknowledgement, it has not put the valid data onto the bus. Okay, the sender asserts strobe bar low and the receiver raises its acknowledgement. The receiver would make this acknowledgement high, and the external device then sends data byte and raises its strobe bar signal. It would put this data byte onto the bus and then it would make this strobe bar high. And after receiving the data by the receiver, it would make this low. Okay, now once this is low and this becomes high, now the next byte is ready to be transferred by the sender. Hope this is clear between the single handshake and double handshake. Okay. So this thing we have already studied. Now, you may ask, what is the need of 8255? Here, just now we have discussed there is a CPU, the PPI, the IC name of this, the number of IC is 8255. This is a PPI. And here you are having some IO device. Okay. So what is the need of this PPI? That is, you may ask directly, why can't we connect this IO device to the CPU? One of the reason is it doesn't have that those many ports which is there onto the CPU. Then the other one is the handshake signals, what it is exchanged between the IO device as well as the CPU or the PPI. So the PPI, that strobe bar signal, the acknowledgement, etc., all of them are sensed by this PPI itself. So the CPU is free, or else what it has to do, it has to poll or it has to check every time whether the strobe bar signal is low or not. Okay. So most of the time of the processor would be wasted. Do you agree to this? Okay. Instead, if we connect this PPI, the handshake signals would be provided by the this PPI itself, so the CPU need not worry about it. Okay, that's why this extra IC, that is 8255, is connected between CPU as well as IO device. So that we'll see here. The parallel port device 8255 has been designed to automatically manage the handshake operations. This is what I have told. It can be programmed to automatically receive and strobe signal. It would receive the strobe signal from a peripheral and send an interrupt. Once it has received the strobe signal from the peripheral device, it would send an interrupt signal to the CPU. Okay, saying that, say suppose a keyboard is there and this is the PPI. Okay, so keyboard has pressed a valid key and it has sent a strobe bar signal to this PPI. Now that the ASCII value of that key which is pressed, that would be stored into a buffer which is there into the PPI. Okay. Now, when the ASCII value is present, it has to be read by the CPU. For that, it will send an interrupt signal saying that I am having the ASCII value of the key which is pressed by the keyboard. Okay. So now, when an interrupt signal is sent, the CPU would get that data and it would process further. Okay, so it can be programmed to automatically receive that strobe signal from the peripheral device as well as sends an interrupt signal to the processor. Here the interrupt signal would be sent by the PPI to the CPU saying that I'm having the data ready. If say suppose strobe bar signal is directly provided to the CPU, continuously the CPU has to monitor this bit, the strobe bar signal. Okay. So that means it is doing polling. You know what is the polling and interrupt, etc. Polling means what? Continuously it has to test this strobe bar pin. Okay. Instead, when an interrupt is generated by this PPI, it has to send an interrupt signal to this CPU. So no need to check continuously this strobe bar signal. Okay. So that's why this PPI is used. It sends an interrupt signal to the processor and sends the acknowledgement. So now, in reference to the strobe bar signal, it will send the PPI itself would send the acknowledgement. So all this, getting the strobe bar signal, providing the acknowledgement, providing the interrupt, all this thing would be carried out by the 8255. Okay, that is a programmable peripheral device. Hope this is clear. The Intel 8255 is a general purpose programmable I/O device which may be used with many different processors. You may, all the Intel processors has or the Intel has designed this 8255, and all the Intel processors nowadays it is embedded within the same IC, but earlier in case of 8086 etc, these are the extra add-on ICs which has to be connected with the processors. Okay, it is used to interface to the keyboard and a parallel printer port. So if you are having a printer port, then also you can program this 8255 for that. So you can see that it is a part of the integrated chipset nowadays. Okay, and the one more reason for using this PPI is that it inserts the wait state. So you know what is the purpose of wait state. Okay, so if some slower device is communicating with the processor, then it the processor should some clock cycles has to be added in the machine cycle, and those are known as the wait states if used with a microprocessor using higher than 8 megahertz clock. Okay, next we'll see about the configuration of this 8255. So this 8255 is having 24 IO pins, which may be individually programmed in two groups. So there are, out of 24 IO pins, 8 would be of two groups, 12 each. Okay, and there are three modes of operation. So we have seen that simple IO, then handshake, single handshake, double handshake, etc. Now, based on those communication method, we are having three different modes of operation of this 8255. So based upon the device which is connected, for example, if it is connecting, say, suppose keyboard, then it may require strobed I/O. Whereas if it is communicating parallelly to some other computer, say, suppose this is one computer, C1, and this is another computer, C2, and if it has to communicate between these two, then it may require double handshake. So based upon that, it may have different modes. Okay, so the high performance and industry standard configuration of the 8255 makes it compatible with the 8086. Okay, so this is the pin diagram of 8255. So as we have seen that there are 24 IO pins, and these 24 IO pins can be grouped into 12 pins, and these 24 IO pins can also be grouped into three different ports. Okay, so you can see that PA0 to PA7, so 0 1 2 3 4 5 6 7. So this forms the pins of port A. These are the IO pins for port A. Then these PC0 to PC7, these forms for the port C. Similarly, you have PB0 to PB7, these forms for port C. Okay, these are the pins PB0 to PB7. This is for port B. Okay, apart from that, the data which has to be exchanged between the IO device as well as the this PPI, so that is carried out using the data lines D0 to D7. You know what is this? Okay, as well as there are some more pins for the like A1, A0, because to select any of these ports, we have two bits which is allocated, A1 as well as A0. We'll see what are these, how based upon this A1 and A0, any of these ports would be selected. So that we'll see how we can select. So whether to perform a read or write operation, so we are having read bar as well as write bar, because based upon whether it is an input device connected or an output device connected, any one of these can be enabled or disabled. Then we are having a chip select line. So you know what is a chip select line? To enable this IC, we require this chip select line as well as the ground pin. Okay, so these are some of the pins apart from these port pins. So here you are having these are the port pins. Now, as I said, it can be grouped into It is either it can be grouped into 8-bit ports, that is PA0 to PA7, PB0 to PB7, as well as PC0 to PC7, or it can be 20. These 24 I/O lines can also be grouped into. It can be grouped into two. In first group, we are having PA0 to PA7 as well as the higher order four lines of this port C. This is my first group, or it is also known as a group A. Whereas in the second group, these pins are included, PB0 to PB7 as well as PC0 to PC3. So you can see that the colors are different here. Okay, so this indicates group B, whereas this indicates group A. Okay, so we'll see how it would work. Okay, so this is the internal block diagram. Of the 8255. So you can see that this here, there is a group A control. I said, what is group A? Port A as well as port C upper. So this forms group A. And it would be, it would be controlled by this group A controller. So this is group A, port A as well as port C upper. It would be controlled by group A up control signal. Whereas group B contains port C lower 4 bits as well as port B. So that would be controlled by group B control. Apart from that, you can see that this is a read-write logic where the read bar, write bar, and to select the ports, A1, A0 would be provided. The reset pin is there to reset this pins. As well as we are having a bidirectional data bus, D0 to D7. These are the data lines. Now these data lines would be connected to the data bus D0 to D7. Hope you have understood this. And this data lines, you are connecting it where? It is connected to the data bus, and where the data bus would be there. So that would be the microprocessor. Do you agree to this? Now the data transfer between this 8255 as well as the processor would be carried out by this D0 to D7 line. The data transfer between these ports as well as the IO device would be connected to the, with these port pins. And to control all these port pins, we are having group A control as well as group B control. Hope everyone is clear with this at least. Hello. Hello. Am I audible? Is it clear, everyone? So the data bus buffer, it is a tri-state 8-bit buffer. So here you are having some buffer, because whenever the data transfer is carried out, first it would be placed onto this buffer and then it would be provided to the processor, or the data which is provided by the processor to this 8255, it would be placed first into this buffer and then it would be provided to some of the output ports of this 8255. So it is a tri-state 8-bit buffer, which is used to interface the processor to the system data bus that we have already discussed. And it is data is transmitted or received by this buffer as per the instruction by the CPU. Okay. Now, even the control word, so which port has to be used, whether these ports has to be used either in the input mode or output mode, etc. All this, for that, the control word has to be generated. Okay. And that control word should be provided by the processor to this 8255. Are you getting this? Say, suppose keyboard is there, whether the keyboard is connected to port A or port B or port C, and whether it should be an input port or output port, all this thing would be provided by the processor to the control register of this. So you have one control register. So that has to be initialized and it has to set all these ports as either in the input mode or output mode. Okay, so that control word would be provided by the processor to the 8255, and that would also be carried out through this data bus itself. Okay, that means all the communication between the processor as well as the 8255 has to be carried out by using this 8255, using this data bus. Data is transmitted or received by the buffer. Apart from data transmission, it should also provide this control word as well as some status information. So say suppose the keyboard is not working, or say suppose printer is not ready to accept the data. In that case, it has to the 8255 has to send the status information of this IO device. So that should also be provided into this data buffer. And from that data buffer, it would provide to the processor. Okay. So this is the function of the data bus buffer. Then this is bit clear chip select line. So if it is a low, okay, so that means the pin that chip is enabled. So usually, even in while we were designing for the memory, we have discussed that when the memory IC all for all of them, usually we had this chip select bar signal. Okay, so when this at this chip select bar pin, if it is low, then that particular IC would be selected or it would be not selected. Okay, low on this input enables the communication between the 8255 and the CPU. Okay, then you are having read bar as well as write bar, which I'm not going in much detail. You know what is the function of read bar and write bar. Now, there are two more pins, A0 and A1. Okay, so if you remember here in this block diagram, you will observe that we are having A0 and A1. Now, when this A1, A0 is 00, it means it would select port A. If it is 01, port B would be selected. If it is 10, port C would be selected. Whereas if it is 11, okay, then a control register would be there within this 8255. As I said, what is the function of control register? To set the mode of port A, whether it is in input mode, output mode, whether it is a simple IO mode or handshake mode, etc. So all these control signals would be provided by the CPU, and those control signals would be provided by the CPU to the 8255. Now, the next pin is reset pin. So this reset pin is connected to the reset pin of 8086. Okay, so you know what is the reset of 8086. What is the reset of 8086? What happens when 8086 is resetted? What happens when 8086 is resetted? What would be the value of CS as well as IP when it is resetted? It is FFFF:0000. Okay, this is the reset value. This happens when the processor is resetted. The CS as well as IP value would be FFFF:0000. Whereas if this 8255 is resetted, then what happens? All the ports would be set to the input mode. All the ports A, B, or C, all of them are set to the input mode. Why is it so? Say, suppose this is my 8255. And some peripheral device is there. Say, this is a printer. Suppose this is a keyboard. Okay. And some data lines is connected. Some lines are connected between these two. Now, when it is resetted, even this as well as this would be enabled as if it is in the input mode. Why is it so? If it would be an output mode, then what happens? So 8255 would also provide this to this keyboard, to this IO device. This would also provide some data onto the bus. So there would be some problem, and there would the device would be, what happens, the device would be corrupted. Okay, instead both of them are made as an input mode. Okay, and to save these devices. Okay, and they by default, any of this peripheral device, when it is set to the when they are reset, all these are set to the input mode. Okay. Now, the next one is group A and group B control. We have seen what is the group A and what is group B. So this is group A and group B. And to control that, we are having two parts, that is group A control and group B control. Each of the control blocks, group A and group B, accepts commands from the CPUs as control board. As I said, every port would be controlled by this control board, which is provided by the CPU. Okay, and configure the ports accordingly. It would be used to configure the ports. And we have seen that what are the group A as well as group B ports. Port A and upper bits of port C are controlled by group A. And port B and lower bit of port C, lower four bits of port C are controlled by group B. So the 8255 has three 8-bit IO ports, port A, port B, and port C. And each one can be connected to the physical lines of an external device. So all of them, port A, port B, or port C, can be connected to some external device or some IO device, and it can be configured either in the input or output mode. These ports are labeled as PA0 to PA7, PB0 to PB7, and PC0 to PC7. So these are some the description of the various pins as well as various blocks of this 8255. Okay, now we'll see how to program this 8255. Fine. How can we program? How the modes would be selected, whether it is a simple IO mode or handshake mode, etc. How it can be done, that we'll see. Now, 8255 can, the majorly it can be configured in two modes. One is known as a bit set reset mode, and the other one is known as a input output mode. Okay. So by using this bit set reset mode, individual bit of port C can be set or reset in this particular mode. Whereas in this IO mode, actually we are having, in this IO mode, again, it is divided into three different modes, mode 0, mode 1, and mode 2. Okay. And whether it should be in the bit set reset mode or IO mode, and if even if it is in the IO mode, whether it is in mode 0, mode 1, and mode 2, so that can be configured by using this control board. Okay, so we are having this control board. So we, and as we know that when A1, A0 are 00, port A would be selected 01, port B would be selected 10, port C would be selected, and when it is 11, then the control board would be provided by the processor to the 8255. Okay, so by looking at this mode, we can make out by setting in this control word, we can make out whether any of this port is in mode 0, mode 1, or mode 2, or whether it is in a bit set reset mode. We'll see each one of them. So this is my control word. Okay, a control word. So the format of this control word is given like this. It is an 8-bit data that's stored in the control register. It is stored, there would be a control register in this 8255. Okay, and as I said, this is used to configure these ports. Okay, and there are two types, bit set reset control word and mode definition control word. So the based upon this IO mode, so which type of mode you are using. Okay, based upon that, we can configure this control word, or it can also be configured as bit set reset control word. Now, I will see each bit of this control word. So the very first bit is D7. So D7 bit indicates whether it is in the bit set reset mode or IO mode. Okay, so if it is 0, then it would be a bit set reset mode. Whereas if it is 1, then it is a IO mode. Are you getting this? The D7 bit, when it is 1, it implies that it is a IO mode, and we can provide the different ports for different modes. So for example, you can see that if D7 is equal to 1, the next two bits, D6, D5, these two bits are meant for, D6, D5 are meant for the mode selection. So if it whether it is if it is 00, it implies it is mode 0. If it is 01, it would be mode 1, and 1 don't care whether it is 10 or 11, it would be in the mode 2. Okay, and the D4 bit indicates the port A. So whether the port A is used as an input mode, input port, or the output port, based upon that we'll have 1 as well as 0. Are you getting this? So you can see that D3, D4, D5, D6, those are the pins for group A. And as I said, group A is meant for port A as well as port C upper. Okay, so this is port A. So whether the port A is in the input mode or output mode, and this port A, whether it is in mode 0, mode 1 or mode 2, so that would be selected by using these two bits. Then port C upper, whether it is in the input mode or output mode, based upon that we can set this D3 bit as 1 or 0. Whereas the group B pins are port B as well as port C lower. Okay. And this group B, port B, it can be set only in mode 0 or mode 1. Whereas port A can be set in mode 0, 1 or 2. Are you getting this? So since it is having port B can be set into only two modes, either mode 0 or mode 1. So only one bit is allocated for setting the mode. You can see that D2 bit, it is for mode selection. If it is 0, it would be mode 0. And if it is 1, then it would be in mode 1. Similarly, the D1 bit is meant for port B, whether it is for it is in the input mode or output mode. Port B is whether it is in the input or output mode, based upon that we can set it 0 or 1. Similarly, port C lower. Okay, so if it is 1, then it is in the input mode, and if it is 0, then it is in the output mode. So these are the bits for group B of this control board. Say suppose if I want to use port A as the input mode, and in mode 0, then I have to set these two bits as 0. Port A should be selected, and if it is in the input mode, then it is 1. And if I haven't mentioned anything, whether port C should be used or not, then I can use it as a don't care. Whereas if, say, suppose port B, I want to use it in mode 1, then D2 bit should be 1. And if it is, it should be in the output mode, then port B should be made 0. And if nothing is mentioned for port C, then you can have it as a don't care. This is how you can set the control word, and you can set any of the ports either in the input mode, input as an input port or an output port, as well as you can select the modes for this. Hope this is clear. Hello. Next is a bit set reset mode. This one, you mean to say. So there are various three different ports are there, okay? And as I said, we are having simple IO. Say suppose mode 0 is used. If I want to use it as a simple IO, then it should be in mode 0. Okay, that if it is in mode 0, then it is in the simple IO mode. If it is in mode 1, then it might be a single handshake IO mode, and so on. Now say suppose port A, I want to use it as a simple IO mode. Simple IO mode is mode 0. And I want to use it as an input mode, input port. Are you getting this? Some device is connected to port A, and that should be in the simple IO mode as well as in the input mode. Then what I can do, I can set this D6, D5 bit of this mode selection. Since I want to set this for port A, and it should be in mode 0, so I'm setting these two bits as 0, 0. If I want port A to be input mode, then I am setting this bit as 1. And I don't want to use port C anywhere, so I'm putting this as well as this as don't care. Hope you are getting this. Now say suppose port B should be used as a output port, and it should be in mode 1. So this is mode 1 for port B. So you can see that 1 stands for mode 1. And since port B I want to use as a output port, so this would be 0. Is this thing clear, everyone? This is how this control word would be generated by the CPU, and that should be provided to the control register. Now, when this control register would be selected? D7 bit is for this mode definition. If D7 bit is 0, then it is in the BSR control mode. So at present, we are considering this as 1. Okay. Now, this control word is provided by the CPU to set different ports, either in the input or output, or in to select the different modes. And that would be provided when A1, A0 pin of this 8255 is 11. Because as we know that if it is 11, then it is for the control register. So that we have discussed here. So this one. If it is 11, then it would be for the control register. Is it clear, everyone? So we'll stop here and we'll continue in the next lecture.